Ever wondered how the rubber in your tires, gloves, and countless everyday products actually comes to life? From the tropical plantations where rubber trees grow, to the fascinating tapping process that collects milky latex, and all the way to how that liquid turns into the solid rubber we use. Today, we're revealing every single step in the incredible journey of natural rubber. Stick around because you won't believe how much skill and care goes into harvesting millions of pounds of this amazing material. The origins and cultivation of rubber trees. Natural rubber begins its journey deep in tropical plantations, where rubber trees, scientifically known as Hevea brasiliensis, flourish. Originally native to the Amazon rainforest, these trees were introduced to Southeast Asia in the late 19th century, and the region now dominates the global natural rubber production. These plantations thrive in the warm, humid climates of countries like Thailand, Indonesia. Rubber trees require rich, well-drained soil to grow robustly, and they typically take about 6 to 7 years before they mature enough to produce latex. Planting and managing these trees is a careful agricultural endeavor, requiring attention to soil quality, pest control, and pruning. Maintaining the plantation ensures that trees remain healthy and productive for decades, as a single rubber tree can be tapped for latex for up to 25-30 years. This long life cycle demands sustainable farming practices that protect the environment and optimize yields. The art and science of tapping rubber trees. The first hands-on step in harvesting natural rubber is tapping, a traditional yet highly skilled method used to extract latex from rubber trees without damaging them. Skilled workers use a specialized tapping knife to make a shallow, precise cut on the tree's bark. This cut is not random, it is carefully angled and often made in a spiral around the tree trunk to maximize latex flow. The incision penetrates the latex vessels beneath the bark, allowing the milky white latex sap to ooze out slowly. This latex then drips into small cups fixed to the tree. Timing and technique are essential. Harvesters typically tap the trees early in the morning, when the latex flow is optimal due to cooler temperatures and higher humidity. The trees are not tapped every day, but rather on a schedule, usually every 2 days, to give the tree time to recover and avoid injury. Over-tapping can harm the tree's health and reduce its productive lifespan, so rotation of tapping spots around the trunk is common practice. This careful balance of skill and patience ensures that the rubber tree remains productive for many years. Collecting and transporting fresh latex. Once the latex sap has been collected in the small cups attached to the trees, the next crucial step involves gathering and transporting this raw material to processing facilities. Latex is highly perishable and begins to coagulate quickly once exposed to air, so it must be handled with care to preserve its quality. Harvesters pour the latex into larger containers or drums, often stationed at central points in the. From here, the latex is transported, sometimes over rough terrain, by trucks or motorcycles, to nearby factories. During transport, it is essential to keep the latex cool and prevent contamination by dirt or other impurities, as this can affect the final quality of the rubber. Once at the processing center, latex from many trees or plantations may be combined to produce a consistent product. The speed and care in this transportation phase are vital to maintaining the latex's freshness and suitability for coagulation. Coagulation, turning liquid latex into solid rubber. After the latex arrives at the processing plant, the next stage is coagulation, where the liquid latex is transformed into solid rubber. Raw latex contains approximately 30 to 40% rubber particles suspended in water, along with proteins and other organic compounds. To separate the rubber solids, a coagulant such as formic acid or acetic acid is carefully added to the latex. This chemical triggers the rubber particles to clump together and form a dense mass called coagulum. The coagulation process usually takes between 12 and 24 hours. This thick rubber mass is then pressed to remove excess water and impurities, resulting in a solid form that can be more easily handled and transported. Coagulation is a critical step because it not only removes water, but also helps to purify the rubber, ensuring it has the right texture and consistency for subsequent processing. The quality of the coagulation process strongly influences the rubber's final quality. Rolling and drying the rubber sheets. Once coagulated, the rubber is further processed by rolling and drying. The coagulum is fed through a series of rollers that press the rubber into thin uniform sheets. This rolling helps to remove additional moisture and aligns the rubber particles, creating a consistent texture that is essential for industrial use. After rolling, these rubber sheets are hung in drying sheds or smokehouses, where warm air or smoke is circulated to thoroughly dry the rubber. The drying process can take several days and is critical to preventing mold growth and spoilage. Traditional smoke drying is a common method, particularly in Southeast Asia. The smoke acts as a preservative, imparting slight antimicrobial properties to the rubber sheets and protecting them during storage and transport. The color of the rubber sheets may vary from pale yellow to dark brown depending on the drying method used. Proper drying ensures that the sheets are flexible, durable, and ready for commercial distribution. Grading and packaging for quality assurance. After the rubber sheets are dried, they undergo a meticulous grading process to categorize them according to quality. Inspectors examine the sheets for impurities, holes, mold, and other defects. High-quality rubber sheets, free from imperfections, are reserved for sensitive applications such as tire manufacturing or medical gloves, where consistency and purity are crucial. Lower grades, which may have minor defects, are used in less demanding products like shoe soles or adhesives. This grading system ensures that manufacturers receive rubber suited for their specific needs. Once graded, the sheets are carefully folded or rolled and packed into large bales for shipment. These bales are designed to protect the rubber from contamination, moisture, and mechanical damage during transport to factories around the world. The packaging also facilitates easier handling and storage, helping to preserve the rubber's integrity until it reaches manufacturers. From raw rubber to finished products. Advanced processing. Raw rubber sheets are just the beginning. They must undergo further advanced processing before they can be transformed into the products we use every day. The first step in this phase is compounding, where raw rubber is mixed with various chemicals and additives. Sulfur is commonly added to initiate vulcanization, a process that strengthens the rubber by creating cross-links between polymer chains. Other additives like carbon black increase durability and resistance to wear, while antioxidants and fillers improve stability and performance. Vulcanization, often referred to as curing, involves heating the rubber mixture to develop elasticity, toughness, and heat resistance, qualities essential for tires, seals, hoses, and many other products. Once vulcanized, the rubber can be molded or extruded into various shapes and sizes according to the intended application. Quality control tests throughout this phase ensure the rubber meets strict industry standards for safety, durability, and performance. Environmental and social considerations in rubber production. Despite its economic importance, the natural rubber industry faces several environmental and social challenges that must be managed responsibly. Sustainable cultivation practices are increasingly adopted by plantations worldwide to minimize deforestation, protect biodiversity, and improve soil health. Rubber trees can help sequester carbon dioxide, but only if plantations are managed without destroying native forests. Socially, millions of smallholder farmers and plantation workers depend on rubber cultivation for their livelihoods. Ensuring fair wages, safe working conditions, and community support programs is crucial for improving quality of life in rural areas. Innovations in biotechnology and agricultural research are also helping increase yields and develop disease-resistant tree varieties, reducing pressure on natural forests. The industry is actively exploring ways to balance economic growth with environmental stewardship and social responsibility, promoting a sustainable future for natural rubber production. Thanks for watching and diving deep into the world of natural rubber with us. If you found this video as fascinating as I did, don't forget to hit that like button and subscribe for more amazing behind-the-scenes stories from nature and industry. Got questions or want to see how other everyday materials are made? Drop a comment below. I'd love to hear from you. Until next time, keep exploring and stay curious.